1875, what became known as the Populist movement began in North Texas. The Populists were farmers who saw their way of life being destroyed by low cotton prices, a lack of cheap credit, and unscrupulous big businesses. In the 1880s and 1890s, Texans like Charles McCune and Cyclone Davis advocated reforms that would provide aid for cash-poor family farmers. Though the Populist movement met a crushing defeat with the election of William McKinley for president in 1896, populism did not entirely die in Texas. It reemerged in a 20th century guise with the politics of Wright Patman. Like earlier populists, the Northeast Texas congressmen looked to government to loosen the money supply and provide special support for family farmers and small businesses. Congressman Wright Patman became a great enemy of high interest rates, tight credit, big banks, chain stores, the Federal Reserve, and Republican leaders from Andrew Mellon to Richard Nixon, who to him represented the arrogance of privilege. This is his story.
The love of money is the root of all evil. But the world hates the truth, and that is why the path is wide that leads to destruction. Without consulting the secret and hidden wisdom of God, without consulting the Bible, we have only babble. And that is why, brothers and sisters, in the Primitive Baptist Church, we do not sing with the piano. We do not sing with the devil's bagpipes. We do not have seminaries. We do not have Sunday schools. We do not have mission boards, because none of these things is even mentioned in Holy Writ. Therefore, keep our eyes fixed on the author and perfecter of our faith. Keep our eyes fixed on our only friend in this derelict world, Jesus.
Friends and fellow classmates of Hugh Springs High School.
Why don't you smile more?
There are some things in life that are just too serious to be spoken of with a smile.
Yes, but the most serious issue in life is being happy.
Yes, and if you can fake being happy, you can have a girlfriend like Pauline Weaver. Now, you're my audience and you can't keep talking on like this. So sit down and listen.
Yes, sir, Mr. Valedictorian.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm listening.
Friends and fellow classmates, envy and scorn are two sides of the same coin. And poverty and decadence are two symptoms of the same disease. But we have a mission to change this, to make and give opportunities. We will plunge forward, suspicious of failure, but confident of success. For we know that failure is not fate, but it is folly. And failure is not the lack of power, but the lack of aim.
Very good, Mr. Valedictorian.
So that Patman boy is courting you, is he?
Yes, Father.
Well, there's something I've been meaning to say. Your mother and I, we don't want you to be trapped.
Trapped? What do you mean, Father?
What I mean is, I don't think you should trust a boy that plows barefoot. If his situation is so poor that he can't afford a proper pair of shoes, then you're not to marry him. Understand? A poor life's not the life I'll have for my daughter. I don't mean to hurt you, but I want you to stop seeing this Patman boy anymore.
Hey, Pauline, what's the matter?
It's just, where are your shoes, right?
Well, they're back at the, well,
in your bare feet.
Well, it's just that the spread wasn't good last year and all.
Your family is very poor, isn't it?
Yeah, but it...
And how are you going to do anything if you don't have any money? How do you expect me to be with you if you don't have any money?
But
I can't do this anymore. I'm sorry.
Ah, Clay. Welcome to my home. Thank you for coming.
Yes, it's quite humble, isn't
it? Yes, it is. I see you brought the book.
Yes.
Thank you.
It looks like you're going to need a lot more than Blackstone's commentaries.
Yes, well, that's a long story. You see, I saved up a few bales of cotton to help pay my way through school, but they were damaged in the Galveston storm. I only got $52 for all of them. Not to mention the fact that my luggage was stolen at the train station in Texarkana.
It's poor luck, my friend.
Yes, well, I know I'll make it. See, I've not had the intention to spend any money on alcohol or cold drinks of that sort, or puff cigars. I don't intend to spend a dime or any time on a young lady either.
Well, with that kind of focus, I don't doubt you will make it, my friend.
My son, a lawyer. I knew the day would come. See here, I brought a flower for your desk.
Thank you, Mother. But what I really need now is some customers.
Well, you know, my son, folks here in Linden would probably feel a lot better about hiring you if you were in more of a family way.
Mom, please, not again. I simply have no time to settle down for a wife.
Would you stop your dismal croaking? Even if you only have apple boxes for shelves and cotton sacks for sheets, a good wife will come in and turn your house into a home and save you money. You are a war veteran, a young lawyer, and a teetotaling Baptist. You're the most eligible bachelor the town of Linden has ever seen.
Well, Mother, I definitely have to give you credit for trying.
So you have at last come to ask for my hand in marriage, ensuring that a number of other young men who just happen to come home from war in Europe won't ask me first.
Stooping to the threats already, my dear? That's not like you at all, is it?
Of course it's not. Threats are so indiscreet for a woman. I only jest. But tell me, why have you come here if not to propose?
I have come on this beautiful day merely to stare at your beautiful face. There's no other reason.
With such a reply, you must think you're very charming.
No. I think charm is quite far from me. But I'm not without confidence. And though I may lack charm, I believe I have something that none of those other men you mentioned have.
Well, what is that?
A mission.
A mission? A mission to do what exactly?
To help the less fortunate.
So you think I'm less fortunate, do you?
No, not at all. In fact, I think I'm fortunate to have you. That is, of course, if you'll have me first.
So you at last confessed that you were going to propose. Imagine the time we could have saved if you would have only been so forward in the first place. But worse still, it's Valentine's Day and you've brought no...
Mel, Connor, will you marry me?
You certainly ask difficult questions.
But the answer is simple. I'll take that as a yes.
Y'all's wedding was beautiful, and your home. How could I have known that any place was going to be so pleasant? And now y'all have more news for me?
Yes, Mother. Meryl is expecting.
Oh, how exciting!
Yes, but it'd be even more wonderful if your son wasn't running for a seat in the Texas House of Representatives. Just when I'm going to have a baby, he abandons me.
Now listen, you know and as well as I do that I can do more for our people by changing the laws in Austin than I can by coping with those same laws down here. Besides, the publicity will help my practice, which means more provision for you and the child.
So, what are you going to name the baby?
Well, if it's a boy, Connor.
Oh, after your last name?
Mr. Speaker, our committee is proposing today a resolution that prescribes the Texas Ku Klux Klan as an impertinence and instructs its national leader, William Joseph Simmons, to stay out of the great state of Texas.
So we have a leader who tried to bring back some fundamental decency to our nation, and you want to treat him like an anarchist?
Mr. Williams, the Klan is an un-American plague whose sores of hatred and discord are breaking out in every town in Texas. They divide the poor and flog the innocent without trial. They are creating their own laws, as opposed to looking to the government to create the laws for them.
And another thing, Connor knows when you're not here. He wakes up all hours of the night, and I'm... Who could that be?
I don't know.
Oh, my...
Don't be afraid, Mrs. Patman. We're not here to hurt you.
Then why else are you here? Have you no respect for the family at all?
Listen, Patman, we're here to warn you. Stop making your tirades against the Klan.
I will do so the moment you stop whipping us as a people.
If you want to join the drunks and adulterers who oppose our great order, you will lose your seat and your practice. You have no idea how popular we are here in Texas.
If I lose my seat and my practice, then so be it. I will not stop opposing you or your ways, for they are wrong. Just look at what you're doing here, breaking into my house and frightening my wife in the dead of night in the name of your so-called Klan virtue. Get out of my house.
So how was the Texarkana Chamber of Commerce meeting last night?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know the one you mean. Patman, right? Yeah, he's the one that campaigned against the Ku Klux Klan in Austin and also faced a Klan opponent in Cass County, who beat him. Yeah. Yeah. He was also in the Texas House too, right? What? He shut the whole place down because of alcohol? He can't do that. I don't care if he is the district attorney. He can't do that. Does he realize he just offended some of the wealthiest residents in the city? So you do. Well, I knew he was shutting down cat houses, but I never thought he would try something like this.
The new district attorney of Patman is stirring up trouble all over town, and he's frustrated my affairs long enough. That being said, I have 10 grand and a train ticket to Mexico for the man who manages to steal him.
You know, in a city like Texarkana, with only 4 Italians I trust, this will certainly be no easy task.
Hence the high pay. But if you do not feel confident, then find the man who is. And get him, and I will give him the job.
It must be tough being in so much debt. The
sentence that I got for defending my affairs hurt like sin. The lawmen in this town are as crooked as ever.
And what happened to you could happen to anyone. If you could only provoke a certain someone to draw on you, why, you know that Wright Patman carries a Smith & Wesson with him.
Yeah.
He certainly knows how to cause trouble for people like us. I'd give 10 grand to see that trouble disappear. I'd give 10 grand to see Patman disappear.
But I'm scared. I don't want to be folding the laundry one day and have some stranger come and tell me that my husband's been murdered and his children are fatherless. Have you ever even considered what will become of us if that ever happens?
Well, that's never going to happen. Now I have to go to the meeting tonight and see what I can do to help. The mayor and the chief police are trying to run down some of the threats we've been receiving from the bootleggers. So I have to be there. Don't worry. Everything's gonna be fine.
People only say that when the exact opposite is true. Right. You are only one man. You're trying to change an entire city. It's foolish. Why do you risk so much?
You and I both know that nothing great is ever accomplished without risk. And you and I both know that our people are never gonna get anywhere if they're drunk. You know that we live in the same great city as our esteemed father, Prohibition, Moore Shepherd. We are part of a generation that is reshaping not only America, but the world. It's for you, it's for the child, it's for America. It'll be okay, don't worry.
Good evening, District Attorney.
Good evening to you too, sir.
Funny running into you like
is
this.
It really?
And long as you're here, I have a question for you. Why is it that crime in Texarkana is increasing? Why is it that law-abiding citizens have to wear a gun belt in order to stay alive?
Now you listen to me, sir. I know exactly why you're here. But I advise you take your next steps with caution. You see, even if you shoot me, there are men standing behind me who would be glad to use this incident against you.
All I'm trying to do is stay alive. It isn't right for someone to have to be unsafe in their own hometown.
Tony Massioli, the bootlegger. You dropped him. Good shot.
I'm glad to be here, Merle. Thank you for having me. Mm-hmm. I can't seem to find a way to talk directly with Wright these days.
His time is precious. And if he doesn't cultivate strong ties with the right people, something very bad could happen. But guess what?
What?
He has decided to run for Congress against Eugene Black.
Congress? My boy? Merle, tell me more.
He has already told me that he's prepared to spend our $3,000 nest egg on the campaign so that he can battle for people's rights. I only wish he'd battle a little more for our own rights.
I wish I could help, dear.
Oh, don't even think that way. Wright was just glad he was able to buy that house and its land for you when he did.
Oh, Wright, he is such an ambitious man. I still cannot believe that the land he received in payment for his legal work had oil. One thing does concern me, Merle. Are you going ahead and joining that First Baptist Church?
Yes, we are. We're both getting baptized.
Well, that is good, but why must it be First Baptist?
And why not?
Well, so many things go on in these big city First Baptist churches that aren't in the Bible. I'm concerned for you.
Well, I don't know why you should be so concerned. Besides, there's another reason why Wright is no longer going to be a primitive Baptist.
And what's that?
He's joined the Freemasons.
What? Taking oaths? Finger in so-called holy books that are not the Bible? Calling God idolatrous names?
Mother.
No! I don't give a hoot nanny holler what his reasoning is. I know Wright. He wants to help the common people so badly, he will do whatever it takes, even if it means doing something that is wrong.
But
I've heard enough.
Mr. Davis?
Well, if it isn't the district attorney.
Pleasure to meet the great leader of the Texas Populist Party.
I'm sure. Patman, why'd you come here?
I have come today to let you know that I have decided to run against Eugene Black for Texas's first district of Congress. And I would very much treasure your consideration in this matter, sir.
Run against Eugene Black, eh?
Yes, sir.
Good, good. That devil's been snorting like a stallion and frolicking like a heifer turning out the grain ever since he came into Congress. He said nothing but trample the McNary-Haugen farm bill. Says it's okay if his constituents have to live off hazelnuts. They can go on getting nothing for their cotton. Well, all the world needs it.
I agree. And I'd further say that...
Oh, you can take that liar out to the woodshed on that. People are becoming so frustrated they're leaving. It doesn't make sense anymore to be a farmer in Northeast Texas.
Better prices and easier credit are two things I'm working for, Mr. Davis.
Well, I wouldn't be too starry-eyed. Did you hear the one where... the oil companies just decided to lay off 15 senators. The government's become so crooked they couldn't talk straight if they wanted to.
Mr. Davis, do I have your support or not?
That depends. Do you support McNary-Haugen?
With all my heart, sir.
Why?
I'll do whatever it takes to have our corn and cotton seed fetch better prices.
What about money?
I deplore high interest rates.
Well, you sure singing on key, all right? I'm not the way to spell to get the big picture. But as for now, you're my man, Patman. You're the only one who's come to get my consideration.
Thank you, sir.
Wright Patman waged one of the toughest campaigns of his life in 1928. His opponent had been Eugene Black, a former supporter of Patman's career who had also attended Cumberland Law School. Patman charged that Black had the support of the conservative presidential candidate, Herbert Hoover, and opposed the McNary-Haugen bill that could bring prosperity to the farms of Northeast Texas. In a major upset, Patman, sticking to the economic issues affecting tenant farmers and small business owners, won the election.
I propose a toast to Prohibition.
Oh, come on now. It's no sin to drink alcohol, especially when you have my foresight.
Foresight? Certainly. Try 10,000 bottles of good wine and another 10,000 bottles of Guinness ale purchased ahead of time. It should outlast us as long as any stupid prohibition. You think of everything.
But Mr. Mellon, where did you get all that English ale?
My former father-in-law owns the Guinness Brewery.
Andrew could arrange for just about anything. Isn't it true, dear, that next to John D. Rockefeller and Henry Ford, you are the third wealthiest man in America?
That's what they say.
So tell me, what do you two really think about Herbert Hoover's election?
That Republicans wondered Hoover more than Mr. Mellon shows just how little Americans know about economics. Hoover's only saving grace as president was reappointing you, Mr. Mellon, Secretary of the Treasury.
Everyone is saying now that Andrew's the greatest Secretary of the Treasury since Alexander Hamilton.
On the contrary, he is the greatest Secretary of the Treasury of all times. Unlike Hamilton, he has served under not one, but three presidents.
What worries me about Hoover? See, he wears his heart on his sleeve. See, he wants to be the savior of Europe. I just hope he doesn't shred the moral fiber of Americans in the process.
On another note, what do you think about the congressional election?
Oh, that worries me too. The McNary-Haugen bill is the most insane piece of economic tomfoolery I have ever seen. And did you know that there is one congressman from Texas who wants to make it his entire campaign?
Right, Patman, you mean?
Oh, that fool. Right, Patman. You know, his name really ought to be Wrong Patman, if you ask me. Wouldn't you agree, darling?
This congressman is becoming the general ismo of a gimme boy campaign. He opens his mouth and out spews everything I oppose. He wants to play Robin Hood, robbing the treasury to give to the poor.
But this is not a fairy tale. He is not truly Robin Hood. He may seem troublesome at the moment, but I'm sure that will fit. Well, if you'll excuse me. Thank you for the invitation. It was a pleasure, Mr. Mellon. Ta-ta.
So where do you think Nora is tonight?
Nora? She's in the middle of divorcing her latest beau, a British antiques dealer who is 14 years younger than her. Yeah, according to my son Paul, she's even thinking of taking my name again.
What? No, don't let her.
What am I to do?
Well, if you were to give your name to another woman, one who truly loves you, she couldn't take it back, now could she?
Big business has failed to recognize that every time a worker is fired, a customer is fired at the same time.
Our critics fail to recognize how difficulty in succeeding can inspire workers, and how high prices can ennoble consumers.
I call on government to intervene on behalf of the American people to save them from predatory big businesses.
I call on every American to respect the rights of great businesses that have made America great.
Each year, the Cotton Seed Oil Trust alone is defrauding American farmers of $25 million.
Our big businesses will produce wealth that will trickle down to the lower classes with unrelenting force.
Good government is the constable that keeps big businesses and banks from cannibalizing themselves.
Unchecked government is a demon seeking to rob enterprise of its virtue.
The veterans of our country deserve their bonus now. Now our country is heading into a recession, and now is the time for more spending.
Shame on those who want to desecrate the contracts of the United States of America. Those who want to pay our veterans an early bonus.
The recent recession is out of control. 1/4 of the American workforce is unemployed. Do you know why the hinterlands smell like popcorn? It's because they are burning their own corn because they cannot afford to buy coal and they cannot afford to sell their livelihood. I call on the government to help these people in this crisis.
As Secretary of Treasury during this crisis, I urge that we as a nation liquidate labor, liquidate stocks, liquidate real estate, and liquidate farmers. This will purge the rottenness out of the system. With high cost of living, high living will come down. People will work harder, live a moral life. Values will be adjusted, and enterprising people will pick up from the less competent people.
The words of the now popular jingle tell the American people just where the country is headed. Mellon has pulled the whistle. Hoover has rung the bell. Wall Street has given the signal, and the country has gone to hell.
You were a part of the fishing club whose dam broke and caused the Johnstown flood? That was the greatest disaster of all time.
Yes, I was a member of the South Fork Fishing Club. Me and a few others who had money at the time, such as John D. Rockefeller and Henry Clay Frick.
The survivors of Johnstown must have come after you with a pack of lawyers.
The flood was an act of God.
But I'm sure no one bothers you about that incident today, do they, Andrew dear?
Oh, just that demagogue from Texas, Wright Patman.
Of course. How could a novice congressman like Wright Patman bother the most notable Secretary of Treasury of all times, the man who served 3 presidents?
He's calling for my impeachment.
What? How dare he?
President Hoover has assured me Patman's finest days are over.
Oh, look, here's our dear Mr. Patman now.
Come in, Mr. Patman and Miss Patman. It is so nice to have you here in Washington. Here, do you know Andrew Wright? And this is?
Mrs. Patman, such a pleasure. And you know, this whole time I was under the impression that your husband was the most eligible bachelor in town.
What a great way to become acquainted, Mr. Patman.
I'm not sure how much I want to be acquainted with the man whose Gulf Oil Drilling Company is using illicit government contacts to directly circumvent Texas oil by drilling in South America.
Like I always told you, Susie, Wright has quite the imagination.
Here, I have something for you. Take some.
Thank you.
It's such a rich place, you might think the blackberry jam would taste better. This tastes awful.
She thinks the caviar is blackberry jam.
You know, there are many Americans tonight that are suffering from pellagra. They will be more than happy to have a dandelion head for supper tonight.
Aw, how dreadful. Right, dear. You should tell them that the people of Northeast Texas do not eat dandelion heads, as they have land and know how to store corn and beans.
Where exactly did you study economics, Mr. Patman?
I studied as the son of a tenant farmer, while watching the citizens of my district scrounge for quail eggs and Jerusalem oak, which they used to pay their doctor bills. I studied life in a shack while studying for my law degree.
I'm impressed your study of quail eggs is helping you understand inflation.
You know, Mr. Patman, if ignorance is your education, you can't help all the people you say you'll help. Right,
just
let's leave.
You Eastern money changers need to know that your reign of terror is over. You, Mellon. You and all the other tax-evading plutocrats here and yonder. Your reign of hypocrisy and corruption that has rained down on the South and the West. You're going to resent this now.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. When I came to Washington, our country was rolling in clover, but now we are knee-high in brambles. Our president, with the aid of his Secretary of Treasury, has used the U.S. Army to drive out veteran lobbyists from Washington. I suggest that he use the army to drive out the international banking lobby. But as my duty to the American people as a member of the House of Representatives, I call for the impeachment of the man responsible for all the suffering this administration has caused. Andrew W. Mellon, for high crimes and misdemeanors.
A nation like this doesn't deserve you, Andrew, dear.
Tell us, Andrew, what has the president decided?
Brutus has found his mark. Rather than going after their gaudy little congressman, they have stepped on me. President Hoover has assured me I will be ambassador to England.
Fleet Street, Piccadilly Square, I can hardly wait!
I knew Hoover lacked guts, Patman. People like Patman should not be determining the cabinet. Well, if you'll excuse me, I have a very important constituent to meet. Good evening to you both.
Susie, I have something to tell you, my dear.
Yeah?
Can I go with you to England?
Well, perhaps not as I am, but certainly after we go through with your plans to...
Plans to what?
To marry me.
As ambassador to England, I can never marry you.
Why, you prude. You hypocrite! You wretch!
Wright Patman, the latter economic populist from Northeast Texas, sent the third wealthiest American of his day into a tailspin. After a short stint as ambassador to England, Andrew Mellon became a target for investigation during the presidency of Franklin Roosevelt. The former Secretary of the Treasury was accused of tax evasion and lived under a cloud of investigation until his death in 1937. Months after Mellon died, despite Wright Patman's accusations that the former Treasury Secretary had committed high crimes and misdemeanors, and despite the hatred of the new president, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Andrew Mellon was declared innocent of all charges related to income tax fraud and the misuse of power.
With its oil money and expanding population, Texas is going to be more and more important to the Democratic Party.
Yes, and if we don't watch that state more closely, we're going to lose it in 1940, just as Al Smith did to Herbert Hoover in 1928.
Mr. President, we will still have strong supporters there.
Yes, but I would not count our dear Vice President, Cactus Jack Gardner, among them. Imagine having the temerity to oppose us on our plan to improve the Supreme Court.
Holding his nose and giving a thumbs down was intolerable. I don't care if he was the Yellow Rose of Texas.
I don't care either. I do have high hopes, however, for that new young man, Lyndon Baines Johnson.
The problem with Johnson is that he's stupid and doesn't believe in anything.
True, but he's folksy, ambitious, and will do anything I ask him.
Would you boys like some lemonade?
No, dear, but your advice would be as valuable as any drink.
I don't know why you guys have to talk about politics all the time. There are many more important issues.
Well, let us just nail down Texas first. Lyndon Johnson and Sam Rayburn will both be important in their own ways, but that Wright Patman will have to be fended off with a 10-foot pole.
Make it a 100-foot pole. That guy is nuts. His tax on chain stores will eliminate every retail store trying to do out-of-state business in the nation. He's still pushing for the payout to Barron's. $3 billion we don't have. He's been the force behind some really crank legislation.
Like what?
Well, take for example, the Patman bill that will pour more currency into our country so that every unemployed steel worker and insurance agent can open their own little barbershop or restaurant, guaranteeing more bankruptcies down the line.
Well, we can't move forward if we don't make economic sense.
Fine. Franklin, tell all our friends that Patman is a skunk that they should stay away from. We have to stop obsessing over the populist money issue.
That's the idea, dear. I was going to say that myself.
Hello, Mr. Davis.
Huh? And who might you be?
I'm Seymour Harris. I'm advisor to Representative Patman. I understood he was supposed to be joining you today.
And why did you come in his place? Where is Patman?
Well, he's doing some crucial work on the bonus bill. He's always working, you see, even on the weekends.
You can just call me Cyclone Boy. Does Patman work on the Lord's Day as well?
Yes, sir, clear through.
Does he drink?
Well, I suppose he has a few shots of bourbon now with the other old bulls of Congress.
Oh. You really must be his advisor then.
Well, Mr. Cyclone, sir, Mr. Patman heard you were unwell. He sent me all the way from Washington to give you his personal regards. But that's not the only reason he sent me. He truly values your opinion. He feels you're the only one in Congress who can help him now.
Well, you can tell Patman that he's talking to someone utterly unbiased, like old Cyclone, because he's dying. But irregardless, tell me what's troubling Patman.
Well, God bless you, Mr. Cyclone, sir. Mr. Patman feels like he's painting himself in a corner. The New Deal people are putting him in groups with inflationists such as Father Coughlin and Huey Long. Even though the real issue is getting money to the poor, they're ignoring the obvious. They're paying attention to big cities and big interest groups instead of helping the good old folk in the village and towns.
The political pimps of Wall Street would like to hush the voice of those who speak frankly about freedom, that is, about money. And now, the savants of Washington would like to join them in disgracing all who plead for the plundered masses against the predatory classes. Tell Patman that he's my hero. Tell him to keep standing tall.
Ladybird, you look rather muley today. Why can't you look more like Nellie here?
Landon, how can you say such a thing? So how are your own affairs going, right?
Things are going very well for me. But you're my gracious hostess, and I should not be so rude as to bore you with politics.
On the contrary, politics and such enormously interesting. It would be no bother at all. And I've heard you become quite discouraged of bankers, aren't you? Go on.
Well, in that case, I was just going to say that I've always believed that those Easterners and the money, the New Deal, I've never really understood the true needs of the poor farmers and bankers of America. They just go on their own way, oblivious to the needs that actually exist. They're hypocrites.
That is the way of the world, isn't it? Everyone going about their own way, no one stopping to notice others struggling on the same path beside them. It impresses me that you, Wright, come face to face and battle with some of the biggest people in the country, and yet have not lost sight of the poor people around you.
Seeing as I grew up as one of those poor people, I could never really lose sight of them, now could I? And I've known so many people at the dead end on the frontier of the American dream. And now they just need that little boost to get them across the threshold. I say, Lady Bird, if your husband could go from being the majority leader under a Republican president to being the president under a Democratic majority, we could transform America.
Do you think so, Ray?
I do.
Well, I know my husband enormously, entirely, positively, and I agree enormously.
Yes, if Lincoln wanted to, he could be the next president in 1960, and Texas would be the first to support him.
Eisenhower is not going to last forever, and Nixon is a greedy-eyed son of a bitch, and the people know it. I want you to know that I am a Wright Patman man, and when I get elected to president, you will get that canal in your district.
Yes, Lyndon, but
I want you to know that there is not a man I feel closer to in all the world. My father recalled working with you against the Klan when they were both in Austin. There's not a man I feel closer to in all the world.
Yes, Lyndon, but on the money question,
we need a society that can feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and give homes to the homeless. And in this upcoming election, you, Wright, will be a very important man in Congress.
Yes, you know I'm for you, Lyndon.
And to further show my support, Lady Bird and I have a gift. It is waiting for you at the house.
Well, thank you. That's very considerate.
Mr. Johnson, can you tell me about plans you might have to run the presidency in 1960?
Well, I'm not saying that I'm going to run, but if I was, I would want this man right by my side.
But why, Mr. Patman?
Mr. Patman has won his 16th straight congressional election. He cannot be beaten.
No, John, you have to throw your influence behind Lyndon. We both know that in 10 years, Kennedy never passed a single bill. Lyndon was behind everything. Yes. Mm-hmm. All right, thank you, John. Hey, Jack? Yes. Yes, a contribution to Leonard would be very good at this time. How close are we? Good. I knew you'd come through for an old friend. Yes, and we'll talk about that some other time. All right, thank you. Goodbye.
Dear Wright, we could hardly believe the outcome of the democratic process in 1960. Robert Kennedy still loathes my husband, but somehow the Democratic candidate, John, seems to realize that Lyndon can make the difference in the South. Sam Rayburn opposed him becoming vice president, but the position gives us national experience with the press and the American people. Thank you again for helping my husband come so close to securing the Democratic nomination 2 years ago. I know how much you did to find support for him. However, things are no longer going so well. The press is all over us. Lyndon's aide, Bobby Baker, is about to be nailed by the FBI, and the Kennedys are keeping my husband in the dark. I think the president is going to give my husband the boot in 1964. It worries me, Lady Bird.
From Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade today in downtown Dallas, Texas.
Lord, our friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
As president and a master politician, Lyndon Baines Johnson pushed through Congress a flurry of reforms. The legislation of Johnson's Great Society included food stamps, affirmative action, civil rights, aid to education, Medicare, and Medicaid. With his long tenure in the House, Wright Patman was a help to the president in passing these bills. He worked tirelessly to support the president. At the end of Johnson's term, Patman wrote the president and said, "I believe that you have done more for the education and welfare of Americans than all the previous presidents combined." Lyndon Johnson wrote back to Patman saying that it had been an honor to receive such support from him. For Patman, according to Johnson, had been the champion of all the little people, the small businessman, the struggling family, and the little children. But as this whirlwind of liberal legislation swept through Congress, there remained the question of how Patman's populist agenda would fare.
Hello, Lady Bird? Yes, it's Wright Patman. I hope this isn't a bad time, but I heard that Lyndon wasn't feeling very well. How is he? I'm sorry. Do you think I could call on him? Laryngitis? Well, I know he shouldn't talk, but I have a gift, a little present that I think will cheer him up. Would it be okay if I stopped by? All right. I'm glad. Yes, thank you. Always a pleasure, Miss Bird. Thanks. Julie, can you get me the president's secretary? Hello, this is Wright Patman. Yes, I want an appointment with the president. Yes, I'm aware that he has laryngitis. No, I already spoke with the president's wife, and she was more than... Look, sir, the president has given me direct access, and this is the only time I intend to use it. So if you would just be so... Yes, that'll be good. This afternoon. Yes, thank you, sir.
Lyndon. How are you? I heard that you were feeling unwell, so I came by to pay my regards.
The doctor told me not to speak to you.
Yes, I know, you can't speak. I don't want you to speak. I've got some things I'd like to speak to you about. But first, here's a present to correct the gift deficit that I hold with your office.
Cufflinks, how? They're made from U.S. 1864 silver coins. Now please, I don't want you to exert yourself at all at this time. And please know that I'm glad to have this time. But there are two things which your friend wants to talk about. One. I believe we need Seymour Harris appointed to the Federal Reserve because he understands that the people need low interest rates. And he's also not intimidated by Wall Street's silly ideas about supply and demand. Then secondly, we need a tough bill on bank mergers. You and I both know that the chase of New York is growing so big that pretty soon this country won't have a Congress, a Supreme Court, or even a president for that matter. Yes, the lead bull is never sick for long. Mr. President, on behalf of the American people, whom you and I both support, I beg you to contemplate these matters and support us.
Hi, John. Look, on the Patman trouble with the Fed, try to ignore him. Oh, he told you that, did he? Well, there's no way I'm even going to bring up the name Seymour Harris. Yeah. I know. Do you know what the opinions of the business leaders are? Yeah. They said that he would be a disaster. Well, look, believe me, John, I'm all for you, okay? Get me the Speaker of the House. Carl, I apologize like hell for putting you through the meat grinder on the Patman deal, but look, I want you to find a way to shut Patman down, and you will have my full support doing so. Yeah, I know, Carl. We will definitely meet difficulty with some of his people in Northeast Texas, but I can tell you that we are going to lose the war if we enter this battle. And listen, to show you how sincere I am going to get you the funds to fix that damn project in Broken Bow. Yes, believe me, I don't want Patman to know I am talking to you about this.
Pauline, it's been a long time.
Yes, it has. And I'm so pleased that you decided to look me up.
Yes, well, after reading of your husband's death in the Gazette, I figured I'd come on over to see how you were doing. I know how difficult these things can be, seeing as Merrill's death last year was particularly difficult to bear.
You have had your fair share of death, haven't you?
Yes. My father's death and then my mother's a few years ago. Then my son Charles died from rheumatic fever. And now even Merrill's gone.
There you always were, our hard-working congressman educating one president after another, all the while bearing such a burden. Yet you never lost an election. Right, you are amazing. My father was so wrong.
Your father?
Yeah, he told me all those years ago to stop seeing you. He didn't want me marrying someone who couldn't even afford a proper pair of shoes. He told me never to marry you.
And that's why?
Yeah, that's the reason why I didn't marry you then.
One of our major obstacles in Congress is Wright Patman. He's becoming ever more powerful and ever more disruptive as chair of banking and currency. The appointment of John Connolly, an old opponent of Patman's, will aid in the legislative process considerably, especially so with Texans.
You know, he won't change Patman, but he'll have a good impact.
I can't wait to see Wright Patman's face whenever we make Connolly's appointment.
Of course! If he can't maul the Treasury Secretary, as he did with Mellon years ago, you know he's going to go after the Federal Reserve Chairman, Arthur Burns.
Patman is impossible.
We have a mystery story out of Washington. Five people have been arrested and charged with breaking into the headquarters of the Democratic National Committee in the middle of the night.
The Democratic National Committee is located in the Watergate office building. The burglars forced a stairwell door, then taped its latch open. The door, now part of police evidence, was noticed by one of the guards employed by the Watergate complex. At first, the police found nothing. Then they spied five men crouching behind some desks.
Neither the president, obviously, or anybody in the White House, or anybody in authority in any of the committees working for the re-election of the president have any responsibility for it.
With regard to the Watergate break-in, I have ordered the entire staff of the Executive Department and all of my top advisors to cooperate with investigations occurring on the federal level. I can assure you tonight that if any of the officers of this administration failed to help this investigation or are found guilty in regard to the break-in, they'll be permanently dismissed from their post. Let me repeat, I am ordering all members of the Executive Department to cooperate fully with this investigation.
I hereby call this committee of the Congressional Banking and Currency Committee to order. Now, the first order of business today is we have Arthur Burns, the Federal Reserve Chairman, here with us to field some of the questions about the $89,000 that were found on the persons of the Watergate burglars at the time of the break-in. Now, Mr. Burns, we now understand that there were some tens of thousands of dollars found on the Watergate burglars when they broke in. Can the origins of this money be traced?
My office is prepared to cooperate with the investigation of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, but not with a congressional committee that, in our opinion, may expose information that would jeopardize the investigation.
Mr. Burns, this is about the 10th time that you or one of your members have stonewalled to our committee over various issues regarding the Federal Reserve. Now, it's no secret that Nixon appointed you to your position, and maybe you are just afraid that he might revoke some of those special privileges that you receive in that autocratic bank of yours. Now, isn't that right, Mr. Burns?
I have no comment on these allegations, Mr. Chairman.
Perhaps you'll comment on this. Is it the duty of the Federal Reserve to serve the American people?
I have no comment on these philosophical questions.
Mr. Burns, can you give me one good reason why you're not in the penitentiary at this point?
Congressman Patman, throughout your 50 years of public service, you have treated the Fed as a sort of evil, but we are here to maintain the financial stability of the United States. We do not receive funding from Commerce, nor do we receive orders from the President, nor any other agency in the government.
In other words, you are not responsible to the people of the United States of America. Now, Congress has, constitutionally, the power to coin and regulate money, and you have usurped this right. Go, leave, I have had enough. Called this special meeting of the Banking and Currency Committee to order. Now we will listen to first an update and summary on this committee's research regarding the money and the Watergate break-in.
Independent of the Federal Reserve, we have learned that the Watergate burglars received funding from Banco Internacional in Mexico City. We have a theory that Republican operatives connected with Gulf Oil have fed money into this international account. We also have information on the plane that is suspected of carrying this money back to the United States.
Has the chairman considered use of a subpoena to follow through with administrative officials about these questions?
Yes, I have every intention to subpoena James McCruder, John Mitchell, and Maurice Stans. Now, someone in this Republican administration is committing the kind of espionage that only goes on in third world countries. And even though this is an election year, we have to get to the bottom of this operation. We cannot tolerate the beginnings of totalitarianism in this country.
Mr. President, I think Wright Patman is a good opponent to have. He's just a populist. He's been against everything big since he entered Congress in the 1920s. Not even LBJ took him seriously.
Yes, but he's persistent to the point of frustration. He won't leave the money issues of Watergate alone.
We've been trying to throw him off. But now that I think of it, he's been in Congress for almost 50 years. There must be some irregularities in his fundraising.
No, Patman lives and breathes money. For 50 years, he's battled the money power in Washington. The big banks, the Federal Reserve. He won't err on something like this.
What about women?
There's an old joke in the 50s that if Elizabeth Taylor and Patman had been on a deserted island together, he would lecture her over the Federal Reserve. We need something more than this.
Well, Mr. President, my advisors have suggested to me that we turn this incident into a civil rights issue. A criminal investigation may imperil a criminal trial. If we turn this into a civil rights issue, we may be able to protect the rights of these Watergate men.
Yes, the ACLU, perfect. But I want something more.
I have more. In addition to our attempts to discredit Patman, we have looked into ways of getting his committee to turn against him. For Committeeman Robert Stevens, we're going to hold up $200,000 of federal money for a proposed senior citizens apartment complex in Athens, Georgia. For Ricky Hanna, the California Democrat, well, we're going to threaten release of the news that he received campaign contributions from the Korean CIA. And Mr. Frank Brasco of New York City, well, we have enough on him that we could hang him from the rafters if he doesn't quit siding with Patman.
Where are the Republicans?
Where are the liberal Democrats?
We are about to decide today the outcome of the greatest political espionage in the case of the United States history. This is unacceptable. Yes, Congressman Stevens from Georgia.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that we proceed with the motion of no confidence in furthering this investigation of Watergate.
Is there discussion on this motion?
I second Committeeman Stevens' objections and add to them that the chairman has been leading this committee in an autocratic manner. The attempt to support your witnesses appears as an open-ended plot to disrupt the government before the election.
Gentlemen, we are looking at an illegal break-in at our own party headquarters. This is not some political year stunt. This is a crime, an act of high treason against our whole democratic process. Now, we have evidence linking money found on the burglars of the Watergate break-in to a bank in Mexico, to Republican operatives. Is it not our duty to proceed? Yes, Congressman Branco from New York.
Congressman Patman, you have been high-handed and essentially undemocratic in these proceedings. The committee as a whole is not with you. This is a criminal and not a congressional investigation.
Cannot believe what I'm hearing. All right, I'll call them for a vote. All those in favor for continuing in this investigation, signify. All those opposed?
The staff of the House Banking and Currency Committee has again been used by its chairman, Wright Patman, to rescue the sinking campaign of George McGovern.
Wright Patman had predicted that Nixon would lose the 1972 election because of Watergate. Instead, Wright Patman's investigation ground to a halt, and Richard Nixon won by a landslide. Nevertheless, the Patman Banking and Currency Committee pioneered a line of inquiry that would lead to the president's resignation 2 years later. Newspapers like the Washington Post and Sam Irvin's Watergate Committee followed the money trail that connected Nixon's White House with political espionage and the obstruction of justice.
I have never been a quitter. To leave office before my term is completed is abhorrent to every instinct in my body. But as president, I must put the interests of America first. America needs a full-time president and a full-time Congress, particularly at this time with problems we face at home and abroad. To continue to fight through the months ahead for my personal vindication would almost totally absorb the time and attention of both the president and the Congress in a period when our entire focus should be on the great issues of peace abroad and prosperity without inflation at home. Therefore, I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
So, your husband was destroyed by the very process he began with the water investigations?
Yes. The new Democrats that came to Washington as a result of the incident, who he calls the Watergate babies. Mm-hmm. So my husband's chairmanship on the Banking and Currency Committee is arbitrary.
So what did they do?
They revolted against Wright, and they gave the gavel to Henry Roos of Wisconsin. It was the biggest blow Wright had ever seen in his entire career. It was what finally made him decide to resign.
Now, remind me again, how many years was that in Congress?
47. Only 7 congressmen have stayed longer.
That's crazy.
That's enough about that. Here come our men.
This world hates the truth. That's why wide is the path that leads to destruction.
Do we have to wallow in all this political sludge again tonight?
Pauline, look at it this way. Your husband took the bull by the horns, and he was gored.
He certainly did deserve it.
But if Sam Rayburn, the mediator, Mr. Austerity George Mahan from Lubbock, Tom Connolly with Foreign Affairs, and Shepard with Prohibition, who is the only Texas hawk left keeping his eye on the prize money?
Begin with the money. You know, before I tie the knot with you, Seymour, I want to know why you and Wright talk about money so much.
Money, my dear, is the seat of opportunity and democracy. When the people have money, they are empowered and enabled.
Well, I don't see the problem. We're a fairly rich country as it is, so why the obsession?
The problem is that money is the root of all sorts of evil, and the rich in this country have the lust for it, and they have figured out a way to take the issue of money off the table of our politics.
Goodness, Wright, you're gonna break something. Open your eyes.
I know in my heart that the people of Northeast Texas and other areas elsewhere will never be safe now. Just look at the areas between the Sabine and the Red River. The feds are coming in, telling our banks how to run. The schools, it's all going to the Fed. There's nothing. The people leave the town, become serfs of large corporations. There's no hope anymore. I don't see what can be done.
Wright, would you calm down? It's not so bad.
Right. Our leaders failed you. But you are a success. You are rich and have outlasted nearly all of your enemies.
But even so, how has it ended but in defeat? And the only place I'll go from here is the grave.
I will rue the day, Wright, for you truly were the last American populist.